Hello everyone. Welcome to the first ever Pete McKee Art History video. If you are new to this channel, then thank you for joining us. Don't forget to subscribe, like, comment and share if you enjoy this video. I'm Ellen, the curator at the McKee Gallery, and today we'll be looking at one of Pete McKee's works of art and we'll discuss its influences. If you're not familiar with who Pete McKee is, then let me give you a little insight into his work and his career as an artist. Born in Sheffield, Pete originally started out as a cartoonist, working for the Sheffield Telegraph. He also drew images for greetings cards. He then began painting, which allowed him to develop a career as a full-time artist, allowing him to leave jobs he had previously relied on, such as working as a postman and as a home shopping picker at Tesco, his last job before becoming a full-time artist. In 2010, he opened up the McKee Gallery in Sheffield, which has sold original paintings and prints of his work ever since. As Pete is from a working class background, his work predominantly focuses on working class culture, often painting people in everyday scenarios. He also has an affiliation with music and has painted many works that pay homage to musical legends. Pete's style is predominantly graphic, with many of his images delineated with strong black lines. These lines echo the cloisonné style, traditionally seen in Chinese pottery, where coloured enamel is divided by thin strips of precious metal. Within the lines of Pete's work are pops of colour, referencing a pop art aesthetic. It is also interesting to note that despite this graphic style, he is heavily influenced by the masters of art, both old and modern. However, more on this a little later. The work we will be talking about today is How We Listen to John Peel, painted in 2012 for Pete's Great Moments in Popular Music exhibition. Depicted is a bedroom scene. When we look at this image, we see signs that this is definitely a teenager's or young adult's bedroom, specifically from an earlier decade. From the single bed, posters on the wall, to the vinyl records under the bedside table, and the vinyl player that peeks out from the bottom left-hand corner, this all harks back to a previous time. The notebook left open on the bed could even indicate this is a university student, who in the middle of their work has left the room for a break. But what really gives away the time frame Pete is referencing is the radio, set up with a tape recorder that has been pressed to record, the red of the button, the only splash of colour in this work. The artist has chosen to colour in this detail as this is the most significant message of the painting. From the late 70s right up until the 90s before the invention of the compact disc, many young people would often listen to the radio and record the latest hits of the day. It was very common for the youth to record radio shows so they could then play back their favourite songs. Particular radio shows that were recorded in this fashion were hosted by DJ and music producer John Peel. One of the original BBC Radio 1 DJs, Peel was the longest serving member of this group and broadcasted his show from 1967 until he passed away in 2004. An alternative DJ, Peel was one of the first broadcasters to play a multitude of genres, including both psychedelic and progressive rock, as well as pop, dub reggae, punk rock, post-punk, electronic music, British hip-hop, and much more. Pete listened to Peel's show regularly and has stated, "Without John Peel, we wouldn't have had an indie scene. He was the main outlet for alternative sound. Long before Six Music, we only had a few scant hours per week to hear and discover the future." The posters and records in this painting reflect John Peel's wide musical interest. On the wall from left to right are posters of Joy Division's Unknown Pleasures album, The Undertones' Jimmy Jimmy, a Nirvana poster, and The Fall's 50,000 Full Fans Can't Be Wrong. The vinyl also alludes to his interest in a wide range of music genres. David Bowie's album Aladdin Sane peeks out from underneath the bedside table. Scattered on the floor is the self-titled album by The Specials, the self-titled album by The Smiths, and Captain Beefheart's Trout Mass replica. There's even a portrait of T-Rex's frontman Mark Bolan on the side table. This painting references a simpler time, before advanced technology allowed people to listen to music on a phone app at the click of a button. Although the painting is not commenting on or comparing how people enjoy music today, it demonstrates the love of music felt by a generation who would dedicate their time to recording the radio in order to play the songs they enjoyed whenever they wanted, which arguably foreshadows the idea behind the apps we use today. Even though the dweller of the bedroom isn't there, we already know so much about them by being allowed this voyeuristic glimpse into the place they will spend much of their time. Now we have discussed the painting's meaning, it is important to discuss what influenced this work stylistically, which may be surprising to many. A longtime enthusiast of Dutch artist Vincent van Gogh, when painting How We Listen to John Peel, Pete drew influence from one of van Gogh's famous works of art entitled The Bedroom or The Bedroom in Arles. Before we discuss the bedroom and how it influenced Pete's work, it is important to give a little background into van Gogh. The artist was born in a village in Zundert in 1853 in the south of the Netherlands to Protestant minister Theodorus van Gogh and his wife Anna Carbentus. At 16, Gogh secured a job as a trainee with an art dealer. He later worked as an assistant teacher, a bookseller, and at one point he even worked as a lay preacher. This is another reason why Pete has an affiliation with the artist, who, like himself, took a while to become an artist, though sadly van Gogh's work did not become successful until after his death. Pete's admiration for this artist is not only evident from the inspiration he has taken from his work, but in how he describes him. The beauty of van Gogh was his single-mindedness. Once he began painting, he never seemed to shrink from this path, maintaining a fierce determination to produce art that went against the grain of what everyone else was doing and had a passion for his own vision. Around 1872, Gogh began writing letters to his younger brother Theo. This correspondence would continue for the rest of his life. In these letters, he would often make sketches, which demonstrated his natural talent for drawing. His brother encouraged this, and in 1880, when Gogh moved to Brussels, he started developing his drawing technique and developing as an artist. Today, Gogh is recognized as one of the leading post-impressionists. His brightly colored artworks with swirling paint are instantly recognizable. His use of color sometimes seemed at odds with the natural world, employing it to symbolize certain emotions. In contrast, his early works such as The Potato Eaters are characterized by a strikingly somber and muted color palette. Gogh's output was prolific. Remarkably, given the astronomical prices his paintings command today, he didn't make much money from his artwork. He lived in poverty for most of his life, his financial instability constantly causing him insecurities about his future. He lived with mental health issues which resulted in the infamous incident when he cut off his ear in 1888. Gogh later admitted himself to a psychiatric hospital in Saint-Rémy in 1889, spending 1 year there. During this year, despite relapses with his mental health, he was prolific in his work, creating roughly 150 paintings. Sadly, only a couple of months after leaving Saint-Rémy, Gogh's reoccurring concerns with his future stability took a toll. He shot himself on the 27th of July with a shotgun and died from his injuries 2 days later. He is now one of the most famous painters of Western art. The bedroom, belonging to Amsterdam's Van Gogh Museum, is a simple interior scene painted whilst the artist was in Arles, France. Pete has taken influence from the layout of this room, including the single bed to the right. He has replaced the hanging pictures and mirror seen in Gogh's original with posters, as well as replacing the stand for washing with a bedside table. It is important to mention that Pete has continued to revisit this bedroom theme in several of his works, and designed his 2020 Teenage Cancer Trust posters around this theme, stating, "Bedrooms are a sanctuary for teenagers, a place you can call your own, on which you can hopefully stamp your identity, even if it's just with a magazine poster or a battered record sleeve. Somewhere to while away summer afternoons, or run to when the world gets heavy. Even if another sibling shares it with you, that space is yours, it's you." Although Pete chose muted tones for his work, bar the bright red record button on the cassette, the colours in Van Gogh's The Bedroom are bright, typical of the artist's style. The yellow of the furniture and the red bedspread contrast with the cornflower blue of the walls and the doors. However, research has shown that the strong contrast is due to the aging pigment changing colour from the original violet. Paint has been applied thickly, evidenced by multiple ridges and daubs, giving surfaces such as the floor, table, bed sheets, and bed a textural appearance. The absence of shadows give this painting an odd quality. Objects seem to almost float whilst the image appears flat. This did not occur by chance, as Van Gogh was profoundly influenced by Japanese woodblock prints, consisting of flat blocks of layered colour, which can create arrestingly beautiful images. It is interesting to note that Gogh painted three versions of this painting. As mentioned, the one we have discussed in this video belongs to the Van Gogh Museum's collection, and the other two belong to the Art Institute of Chicago and Paris's Musée d'Orsay. This is where we will conclude our video. We hope you have enjoyed this art historical insight into both Pete McKee and Van Gogh's work and the connection between the two. Don't forget to check out our next art history video, where we will examine another McKee work and its influences that draw on the history of art. Many thanks for watching.